In the midst of life, we are in death. From whom can we seek help? Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. In his death, Christ destroyed death. And in his rising, Christ restored life. And Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Ernie Eldridge put on Christ, so in Christ may he be clothed in glory. Friends, my name is David Johnson. I'm the pastor here at Point Pleasant United Methodist Church. And as we celebrate Ernie's life today, we know that there will be moments of grief, but we trust in God's grace to offer hope. And we know that there will be moments of pain, but we trust in God's grace to offer comfort. And we know that oftentimes it feels like death has the last word, but we trust in the promise of resurrection. Let us pray. O God, who gave us birth, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray. And you know our needs before we ask. And now, as we shrink before the mystery of death, we ask for your grace that we may see the light of eternity. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, so that we may live in everlasting life in the presence of God our Savior. Amen. Our first hymn today is Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. It is number 133 in your hymnal, and I invite you to stand as we sing together.
Thank you.
This morning, we are leaning on those everlasting arms. And we know that Ernie has been fully embraced by those same everlasting arms. We give thanks for the fullness of the promises that he has received. Some of the promises that Ernie has received now are laid out in the 23rd Psalm. The psalm has the promise of God's presence, the promise of God's abundance, the promise of God's comfort, and the promise of God's eternal life in the presence of God. Let us share the 23rd Psalm together. If you know the words, I invite you to join with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Our second reading today is from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and I'm going to invite Hack Spivey to come forward and read that. You can either read it right there.
Good morning. Chapter 3. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. Thanks be to God.
It was interesting as I met with Mary Lee and John and Lori and Chad a while ago. We were just kind of talking and telling stories, and this scripture came into my head, and I made a quick note, and then later we were talking about what scriptures might want to be read at the service, and Mary Lee said the same scripture. The first thing that comes to my mind when I hear those words is that timing is everything. The scripture talks about things that are opposite, and yet both are certain times in our life. Both are what we deal with. I did not know Ernie well, but as I met him, I did learn about him, and I recognized that there always seemed to be a time for certain things. I learned that there was a time for meeting Clint Eastwood at his restaurant, the Hog's Breath Inn. Ernie liked to share that story. There was a time for seeing Jane Russell and Jane Mansfield at the Visalia Parade. There was a time for staying up late on Friday and Saturday nights watching scary movies with his kids. But there was never a time for being late for church on Sunday morning. after staying up late. There was always a time for a sweet tooth, whether it was Pepperidge Farm cookies or Hostess desserts, frozen, of course, peanut M&Ms or donuts. And there was never a time when the pantry was closed. It didn't matter who was around. If someone wanted a snack, they got one. There was a time every day for chores to be done. And there was a time, many a time when the words, wait a minute, would bring projects to a screeching halt so Ernie could make sure the details were properly thought out. There was always a time for helping others. I heard story after story of him giving to those who needed it. He was the kind of guy who helped people who were in trouble. He paid for all his friends at meals. He made sure every kid on the baseball team he coached was included in the celebrations at A&W. There was a time for giving. Seems like every charity has a commercial on TVs these days. And Ernie thought it was important to make sure that they gave. There was always a time for commotion. Ernie thrived on activity and noise in his life and in his house. And he always wanted people around and always made them feel welcome. I learned that there was never a time for a dirty car. His cars were immaculate. I wish I could teach my kids that same that same lesson. And there was always, always time for his family, especially his grandchildren. Timing is everything. For Ernie, there did come a time of sickness. There was a time of struggle. And for him and for each of us, there is a time for death in this world. But for Ernie, and for the life he lived, there will always be time for memories. There will always be time for legacy. It was a late night when we met together, and I think there's always time for one more Ernie story, right? And for Ernie and for us who will receive it, there is a time for resurrection. There is a time for each of us to choose to receive the promises of God, those promises of abundance and presence and comfort that the 23rd Psalm talked about. And those are the promises that Ernie has already received. So take heart, because today Ernie is made whole and complete. For him, there is no more pain, no more struggle, and no more tears. And for that, we can be thankful. Amen. Our next hymn today is In the Garden. It's number 314 in the hymnal.
Thank you. On behalf of our family, I would like to thank you all for being here today. We have received countless phone calls, cards, emails, texts, delicious meals, and many thoughts and prayers. They have been both comforting during this difficult time and also a reminder of the impact that Ernie had on all of us and many others. Ernie was born in Lilburn, Missouri, to Ernest and Susie Eldridge on July 13, 1938. He was the oldest of three. Betty was 2 years younger, and Bob five years younger. When Ernie was 5 years old, the family moved from small town Lilburn, population 1,378, to the big city of St. Louis, population 800,000. Can you imagine what the difference that was? They stayed in St. Louis until he was 13, and then they came to California, first to Visalia, and then to Bright, near West Sacramento. He married at a young age to Carlene and had four children, Colleen, Carrie, Connie, and Bert. They moved with their mother and stepfather to Texas, but he was able to keep in touch with Colleen and her husband, Dell, and their two children, Courtney and Josh. While cruising J Street one night, on a Saturday night, he met Marianne Froelich, who he called the love of his life. They married in 1963 and had Johnny a year later and Lori in 1966. Point Pleasant became their home, where they were surrounded by family. Ernie coached Johnny baseball, and they spent countless hours working on cars together with the advice from Grandpa, John Froelich, who Ernie said had a tool for almost everything, and if he didn't, then he would make one. Kingsgate was a place to be on Friday and Saturday nights when Johnny and Lori were young. After a night of skating, they would sit on the couch together and watch those scary movies with creature features with Bob Wilkins. Ernie worked for 27 years for Crystal, retiring in 1997. Part of his retirement opportunities was to be a caregiver to Emma, his granddaughter. They often stopped by Carl's Jr. for chicken stars, and he did the same thing with Hack when he was little. The ladies in the drive-thru just loved his big brown eyes. Sadly, in 2004, Marianne lost her battle with ovarian cancer. They had 41 years together. His children and grandchildren helped him to figure out how to live without her. He often told me many times that her death almost killed him. In making a life together, Ernie and I found each other in this church 17 years ago. We had both lost our spouses to cancer. We understood each other, the grief, the pain, the loneliness, and the need for someone to talk to. In making a life together, we honored the things that our former spouses loved. Ernie and Marianne loved Catalina. So Ernie took me to Catalina. We were in pretty good shape back then when we first started going, and one day he decided that we should walk over the hill to the desalination plant, which seemed like a good idea, but we chose the hottest day of the week in the middle of the afternoon. It felt like it was uphill both ways, and I was going to die. The next year, he rented a golf cart for me. I shared my love of family camp with Ernie. We went every year until the pandemic. Ernie's first year was trial by fire. In our 30-foot RV, we had five grandchildren. Sleeping arrangements were a bit tough. We had one on the table, one on the sofa, one on the overhead bunk, and two on air mattresses on the floor, and we had about this much room to walk back and forth. They rotated each night, and only one of them fell off the bunk. He really liked going in the RV, and we went on many spontaneous trips to the coast with Ron and Gina. And unfortunately, almost every trip involved a flat tire. His grandchildren were very special to him. He loved going to the county fair to watch Ashley and Kelsey show their sheep, Emma to ride Maverick in her equestrian drill team and showing her goats and steers. Miranda showed her rabbit, and Hack showed goats and steers. I have a picture of Hack showing his very first steer, and all you can see of him are his legs because his head doesn't come to the top of the steer. But he could make that steer do whatever he needed to do. He really enjoyed all of the sports that his grandchildren participated in. Hack and Zach playing t-ball, Emma and Hack playing baseball, and he especially enjoyed Hack playing football and making all those tackles. He liked donkey basketball as well. In 2014, when Ernie was diagnosed with Alzheimer's type dementia, we started on another adventure. With the help of state-of-the-art medications and some wonderful doctors, the progression of the disease was relatively slow. We continued to do what we had always done, but with some minor changes. I was blessed with a support system like no other. We watched as his memory slowly faded away. He was never very good with names, so that really didn't become a problem. He was just happy to have visitors come and listen to his stories over and over. Ernie was a storyteller. He had an endless supply of them. Zach and Christian remember the stories of his friend Boots, who was the best football player that he'd ever played with, and that Opa could throw the ball the length of a football field. When Gina would come to stay while I ran errands, he would talk aloud about his father and what a great person he was. Ernie never hesitated giving his opinion or advice. When he was in the hospital for a couple of weeks during COVID, the family was able to be with him and to help relieve his anxiety and make sure he didn't remove his IV. One afternoon, Hack was with him, and he had the sweetest conversation about finding the right girl. And Ernie's advice was to be patient, and you'll know when the right one comes along. Hack recorded that, so we have that preserved for all times. As we celebrate his life today, he lives on in the stories we will share about how he touched our lives and in the love that is visible in the eyes of his family, his friends, and the legacy of his children and great-grandchildren. Things will never be the same, but our world is better for the 84 years that he lived. The precious man that I have loved and cared for is gone. His voice is stilled. The place he took in our home is vacant and can never be filled. God, in his wisdom, took him home, and his soul is in a safe place.
At this time, we're gonna have a slideshow, and then we have a few people who are going to share. But if you have a story you would like to share, I invite you to start thinking about that now, so that when the time comes, you'll be ready to go.
Bye. the Lord comes and calls, calls me away, oh yes. Where the morning's so bright and the lamb is the light, and the night, and that is it.
There will be peace in the valley for me someday.
There will be peace in the valley for me, oh Lord, I pray.
There'll be no sadness,
no sorrow,
oh my Lord,
and no trouble.
Trouble I see,
there will be peace, peace in the valley for me.
When you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I will dry them all. I'm on your side.
Sail on, silver girl, sail on by. Your time has come to shine. All your dreams are on their way. See how they shine.
So as we get set up here, I wasn't planning on talking, but I thought of something this morning. And honestly, I need a minute to get through this. My opa, when I sing this song, we're going to sing I Hope You Dance. I wasn't planning on singing in general, but I was asked to because this is one of his favorite songs. There's a specific line in it that I've been thinking of as I practiced, and it's, don't let some hell-bent heart keep you bitter. And one thing that is still said in my household, as a quote from Opa, is, you can't best a fool. And as crazy as that sounds when he would say it to us, when we would have issues with friends or with people that we didn't think liked us, it meant just be happy in what we have, be grateful for family, and be strong in who you are. And I just wanted to share that because that sticks with me every day, that he would always say that to each of us. Thank you all for being here today to celebrate him.
Forbid love ever leave you empty-handed. I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. When you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. I hope you dance. I hope you never fear those mountains in the distance. Never settle for the path of the least resistance. Living might mean taking chances there were taken. Loving might be a mistake, but it's worth making. Don't let some hell-bent heart leave you bitter. You come close to selling out, reconsider. Give the heavens above more than just a passing glance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. I hope you. Hope you dance. I hope you dance. I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. I hope you.
And I believe Hack had something to share.
Hello, hello. I can't sing as good as her, so I'm going to read. So this was actually written by my cousin Ashley, who lives in Georgia and could not be here today, but she wanted me to relay this message to all of you. My Opa was a man who did not mind sitting in the shadows. When I was little, Oma took center stage in our lives, but he was always there. He took us to Catalina Island, their place, but he knew that it was our year to go. He still took us, grieving. And even though it was hard, I was thankful to go and thankful to him. He even drove us three girls to Catalina by himself, something that I don't even remember him doing before. It started my firsts with him, and I was thankful. When his first Christmas came on his own, he asked me what I wanted for Christmas. It was this Carhartt jacket that I loved at the feed store, and I believed my mom put it on hold after I tried it on for Opa to go and buy it for me. I still have that jacket. It still fits. I still wear it when it gets cold, and I still think of him when I wear it. Before Marilee joined the family, Opa would join us every week for pizza. He came over, I believe it was Fridays, always with two pizzas in hand, and visited. Even though he was grieving, I enjoyed his weekly visits. He never missed an event, and if you knew my grandparents, they were always late. But Opa on his own was always on time. He sat front and center at my high school graduation, was there for my wedding, and all three of my kids loved him. I got to know him more as an adult when I was attending community college. He was always happy and laughed more as he got older, and I loved seeing that. Thank you, Marilee, for always being there for him and loving him. When he came in Ofa Opa, which is a great-grandfather, it was awesome. My daughter was the first one of many, and she loved him. My sons enjoyed having him watching them swim and the big waves they can make. We would FaceTime after we moved, and all three of the kids competed over who Opa and Gigi got to watch first. My three kids will miss him very much, and he was so loved by them. As his health declined, I enjoyed knowing when my aunt, cousins, and grandparents were together so that I could phone in. Even though I was on the phone, I enjoyed being a part of the camaraderie and conversation that they were having. It really reminded me of when they had a family. It really reminded me when they had family and friends get-togethers at their house. I especially enjoyed the poolside barbecues that we would have as adult grandchildren. He and Marilee would sit with us all under their large tree in their backyard, and we would go back and forth to the pool. He was always there. He didn't have to take center spotlight to love us and be there for us, but he was. Opa was always there. You will forever be missed and loved. That's it. Thank you.
Are there others that would like to come and share a story about Ernie? You don't have to come all the way up here. We have a mic. I can bring it down to you if you'd like. Yeah. That might be off.
Good morning. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Heather. I'm Marilee's daughter. Ernie loved me and my brother and my kids like they were his grandkids, and I was his daughter, and he just loved my boys. The one story that I will remember is specifically with Christian. We would go over and have dinner on Wednesday nights before choir. And we would sit around the table, and it would be Ernie at the head of the table, and it would be Christian, then it would be me, and then it would be Zachary. And Ernie and Christian would just get into it at the dinner table. They would glare at each other. Christian would hit Ernie or slap his arm. Ernie would slap Christian back. This would go on for weeks and weeks and weeks. And I would glare at Christian and say, stop it. But Ernie would just dig at him and keep doing it. Finally, in the wisdom of being a mother, I decided I'm going to sit between Ernie and Christian. Do you think that stopped it? No. And Christian always said he loved it when Ernie would give him the stink eye, give him that dirty, dirty, dirty look. But I will always remember Ernie just loving on my boys and being there for him, for them.
Are there others who would like to share? As I said, there were a lot of Ernie stories that I heard, and some of them might not be the most appropriate for this room, right? But there will be a time for fellowship following this, and I encourage you all to share with the family and to remember those stories and to remember him. Our closing song today is Softly and Tenderly Jesus is Calling. I invite you to stand as we sing. It is number 348 in the hymnal.
Thank you.
One last thing about there being a time. There was a time for prayer. I met with him a few days before he passed, and he didn't have a lot to say, and he was struggling to remember. But when we joined together to pray, and we prayed the Lord's Prayer, he knew every word. Let us pray that prayer together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before we dismiss into the fellowship hall for fellowship together, I just want to say thank you on behalf of the family for each one of you being here. I know they have felt your love and support. I'm going to give a benediction, and then I'm going to ask the family to go ahead and step out to the fellowship hall, and then we'll process out and meet them there. May the blessing of God, the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Go in peace. Amen.